You're watching TVC Breakfast. The Chief Justice of Nigeria and Chairman of the National Judicial Council, Justice Tanko Muhammad, has summoned the Chief Judges of Rivers, Kebbi, Cross River, Anambra, Jigawa and Imo States to an emergency meeting. This is part of efforts to stem the recent wave of embarrassing and conflicting ex-party orders emanating from judges in their jurisdictions. Heads of the concerned courts had to brief the CJN on incessant granting of conflicting orders on suits instituted by various political parties before the various courts. And the National Judicial Council had earlier warned judicial officers on the need to be circumspect in granting ex-party applications. That's the foundation of our discussion this morning. I have with me two lawyers to help us make sense. In fact, we're going into the classroom now on understanding what all of these is about and what the consequences could be or the implication, as the case may be, and what we need to learn from there. I have Jide Ologun here in the studio. Barrister Jide Ologun, good morning.
Good morning, Mike.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
Great. And I also have Barrister Tunji Abdulhamid. Good morning. Good to see you.
Good to see you. Good morning.
With both of you by my side, left and right, I'm going to be very learned this morning. So let's start somehow. Jide, let me start with you. Now, if we take the one of the first cases we'll be looking at is the issue of the PDP national chairman tussle, where a court in River State says, Uche Secondus, stop parading yourself as the national chairman of the party. Days later, another court in Kebbi came and said, no, you are the chairman of the party. Days later, another from Cross River came and said, you cannot be chairman of the party. It's still the same issue, still the same. Make us understand, why would anything like that even occur in the first place?
You know, it's because we are declining in the expected standard and ethical approach to professionalism. Because basically, when you have a matter in court, if you are not satisfied with what you are obtaining from there, you proceed to a court of higher jurisdiction, not the same of coordinate jurisdiction. And then when you look at why this is going on, we need to take it back to the Constitution. The courts are creations of the Constitution. And if you look at Section 15, Subsection 5 of the Nigerian Constitution 1999 as amended, it says that the state shall abolish corruption and abuse of office. And these are agents of the state that are expected to uphold the integrity of governance. And that is why the Chief Justice of Nigeria himself is worried that, okay, you need to come and explain why you are giving all these orders that are embarrassing, because there is an insinuation of manipulations and that politicians are probably out to overrun the sanctity of the judiciary. But having said that also, I believe that it may be a systemic crisis, in the sense that, don't forget that in the case of Imo State, the Supreme Court also, you know, got pointed at that what kind of decision is this. But the Supreme Court has a way out by saying that once we have come to a conclusion, we cannot knock off that conclusion. Perhaps in a similar case in the future, we may try and amend our ways. But by and large, all these are presenting before us a picture of the need to revive the pride of the judiciary, because it's not just the Chief Justice of Nigeria that is concerned. Nigerian Bassians are concerned. Nigerians are concerned. And the world is watching, because we were taught in the law school that justice should not only be done, but clearly seen to have been done.
And in fact, in some instances, that seen to have been done sometimes is even more important
for people. Clearly seen to have been done.
That feeling of it seemed to have been done sometimes can be more effective in the minds of the people. Now, Tunji, let me come to you on this. The point there is, this ex parte application, now he was talking about court of coordinate jurisdiction, and when we have a court in River State, or any state for that matter, come up with a case concludes on a case or has a ruling over a case, and then we have another court of coordinated jurisdiction somewhere in a part of the country, come up looking at the same case. Is this an issue of mischief or the lack of knowledge of the fact that, oh, this case has been dealt with, or there's a ruling over this case from another court? Is it the lack of that information, or is it just mischief?
I would want to say that it's a mischief.
Okay.
Even though some of them want to argue and say, by my role as a judge, I don't have a duty to look outside what is before me in the court. In other words, the court judges decide cases based on what is presented before them, not what is read in the newspaper or what they heard from the news or whatever. That is also a reason for them. But to me, a sincere judge or a sincere lawyer who is aware of what is going on in the country, and they should be. They should take judicial notice of what is going on in the country. If I were to be a judge in that circumstance, if you bring that kind of a case to me when I'm aware that there's another case in River State or somewhere else, even though it's not before me, I would tell you, look, Mr. I will ask question. Mr. Kini, are you not aware there's a similar case somewhere going on in the news?
On this matter.
Is that correct or not? Or even if I don't want to go that way, I can say, okay, well, this matter, as far as I'm concerned, it can still stay for a week or two or 3 days. Why can't we abridge the time, go and serve the other party and put them on notice?
But should this be left at the discretion of the judge, or there should be a standard as to how to approach
see,
it?
You see, the granting of an order, especially ex parte injunction or motion injunction, is at the discretion of the judge. But that discretion must be exercised judicially and judiciously. In other words, it must be based on facts before him and the provisional principle of law as available at that time. So you see, sometimes it's sad and unfortunate that some judges and lawyers, particularly senior lawyers, have allowed themselves to be used by politicians, to be used as tools by politicians who are desperate to achieve their desired result. And now, sometimes you see, we don't blame these politicians, because if the lawyers are not willing, if the judges are not willing, they won't be able to achieve any result. And you see, when we say ex parte application, we are talking about a situation whereby it is either life or death. In that circumstance, if that application is not taken, or that something is not done, something is not done, it will be either a death or irreparable damage will occur. In other words, you can only grant an ex parte application where it is difficult in that circumstance. If it's not granted, something else that is terrible will happen.
So you have to give it priority.
You see, that must be emergency. Extreme emergency. You cannot just be using it for a situation whereby somebody is already a chairman of a party. He's been there. If he's removed or if he's not removed, nothing. It do not affect anybody. He do not die. Nobody will die. Even if he's removed there illegally, he can still go to the court and challenge it, and he can be restated. So, to me, I don't see any reparable damages in that one for you to say. Initially, I'm saying that first order ought to have been granted by ex parte. Now people are now going from one place to another to search for.
Looks like ex parte application or injunction is something you can just go and buy or shop. You just shop for. You go and there. How much is it?
That is the impression you're having. It's not for sale, really. But
it's not meant to be for sale.
Exactly.
That's what I've been giving. Yeah. That is the impression I've been giving.
It's not meant to be.
Yeah, it's not for sale. Okay. In an ideal situation, but explaining it in the very simple term, it means the other party is not put on notice. So you can just walk in there, persuade the court and get it. And it is an interim order. It's not a permanent one. It can be vacated. It's just to sustain what is on ground, like Barrister Abdulhamid brilliantly mentioned, so that we don't have a harm. And in many cases, it's when you are confronted with financial harm. Maybe there is sex harassment or child abuse somewhere, and we must stop this before we attend to the substantive issue. Then the court can say, okay, let me grant it. Otherwise, you ask that the other party be put on notice. You can see the case between the federal government and the National Association of Resident Doctors. Mm-hmm. Now, resident doctors say, we are just reading about these decisions in court. And even in that case, the judge said status quo should be maintained. And in law, we say that is vague, because status quo will now be interpreted by both parties.
Which of the
status quo their position.
Yeah.
And status quo, strictly so, means the current situation.
Hmm.
And ideally, the current situation, by the time the party went to court, was that there was a strike. So that should be the status quo that should be maintained. But the judge could have gone for that to say, okay, I'm giving you an order, go back to work, you know, expressly.
Hmm.
Or don't go back to work. So we find situations where some of these decisions are just left hanging in the air, and parties are now left to start interpreting. And that does not in any way help the grooming of sustainable justice, because justice simply means doing the right things.
Mm.
And why do we have this this process? It's to regulate the society, because from the micro level of the courts, it escalates to the macro level of the entire society. And that is why when some politicians or some people know that, okay, we can go in there, grab 3 trillion naira of Nigerian resources, then we just go and hang it in the court there. You know, so these are issues that are of concern.
Mm.
And going beyond even these decisions we're talking about, what about the operational integrity of the court? I want to express my concern again. In the case of Nnamdi Kanu, that was not brought to court because of logistic challenges, which could have been, maybe there wasn't a Hilux van to bring him, I don't know what the logistics. I would have, as a judge, ordered that I'm not leaving this court. Go to my pool of vehicles, bring this young man to court, let justice be served. Like Barrister Abdulhamid mentioned, the judges are powerful. You address them as my lord.
Mm.
So if you are not satisfied with what my lord has pronounced, you go to a higher court. And we have the high court, we have the Supreme Court.
Mm.
And when you get to the Supreme Court, after 1963, that is the bus stop.
Mm.
Whatever you get from Supreme Court, the next court is the court of heaven. So we need help. If we begin to present a society where the judiciary cannot be trusted, we are being confronted with dear danger.
Then we have issues on our hands. Now, talk to us, Tunji, about the issue of territorial jurisdiction. Now, there are instances where the court that should make a pronouncement or a ruling should either be close to where the case is, and then there are instances where we see sometimes there's a ruling from another, you know, a court from so many hundreds of miles away and all of that. What kind of cases does this apply?
You see, when we talk about a jurisdiction of the court,
mm.
these jurisdictions are determined by constitution and the law.
Mm.
It is clearly stated what and what a court can do, what a court cannot do, what kind of cases can be filed in the particular court and cannot be filed in the particular court, why you should file a case in a particular jurisdiction and not a particular jurisdiction. But you see, sometimes the lawyers are smarter sometimes. In an attempt to achieve their mischievous goal, they will think they are smart. Because what they will be arguing now is that, look, those who file the case in Kebbi State are PDP members in Kebbi State and not Uche Sekondo. And they were just fighting on behalf of their party. Because they will tell you they have the responsibility to also defend their party and to ensure that things go well in their party. But if, like I said, if that may be their argument. They will not put Uche Sekondo as a claimant or the will be a defendant in that case as well. Yes. So they will now go to court and say, this is what is happening here. So
it's like saying, we want you to contest for governor. If you don't contest for governor, we'll sue you.
Yes. what you now do is to say, look, to distinguish, because what we say, a case is a particular court.
Mm.
Once the parties are the same, the subject matters are the same, then the court cannot be handled by that. But they will now want to differentiate and say, look, those who file these cases are not the same as those who file the one in River State. They are different people. But the issue is that, as the subject matter, is not the same?
Mm.
The issue is all the subject matter in River State borders on the office of
the national chairman of the PDP,
the one in Kebbi, but that's on. And if, like I said earlier on again, as a judge, you need to take judicial. That gone are the days where people don't, where we don't get information until after days or, mm-hmm. or months. Today's when information comes out, even before we leave the studio, you are at your fingertips. Mm-hmm. They are there. I'm aware the judges are aware of what is going on. And if I were to be a judge, I would ask them questions. Address me why I should entertain this matter before in this court. When I'm aware that there is a case in River State in that, regarding this matter. In fact, the federal court has, made a regulation to the federal, a directive to the federal, look, parties direction to the federal, look, if you are filing a case in, at the federal court, you must swear to another affidavit to say that I am aware that there is no similar case or there is not in any other court in this country regarding this matter. So I think other courts should also do that.
Yeah, but if we have that kind of instance where we're talking of how aware or not that you are, if there is a case somewhere and you are not aware, or you could claim that I'm not aware, wouldn't that suffice?
Yeah, you can claim that. I'm saying that is the mischief of the one I'm talking about. But in this case, anyone I say is not aware, that means it's not even fit to be in that position.
I see.
Because that means it's not aware of what is going on around him. And it's not fit. So you see, anybody that says he's not aware of what is happening, he's just deceiving himself. And you see, I tell you, if not for the summon by the CJN, mm-hmm. probably today we'll be talking about some other counter injunctions from other states. Maybe they have even gone to my state, in Kwara State, to obtain another one regarding that matter. That is the truth. That summon is what has temporarily stay or let us maintain the dignity
for now.
You see, it is unfortunate that we are degrading the judiciary. We are killing the system, and once there is no confidence in the judiciary again, there is no country as far as I'm concerned.
All right. Apart from the issue of the case of the national chairman of the PDP, there's also the issue of ABGA within Anambra State towards the governorship election later on in the year. Now, talk to us. The CJN has stepped into this to salvage the situation. We also see reaction from the NBA, you know, as regards raising an alarm and sending a warning to saying that we will not condone this and all of that. What do we expect to change from this now? Because this is not the first time that alarm is being raised on this kind of conflicting orders.
In public relations, we refer to that as stakeholders engagement. Mm. They must come together to salvage the situation. And don't forget that recently also, the NBA, through the president of the NBA, you know, alluded to the fact that the processes of appointing some judges was not very deep and sound, but though the processes still went on with some complaints here and there. So we are to checkmate one another. And if you take it to the larger spectrum, we have three arms of government: the executive, the judiciary, and the legislative. And we studied checks and balances in secondary school. Mm-hmm. So if we are complaining that the executive is not living up to expectation, legislative arm not living to expectation, it's been commonly said that the judiciary is the hope, the last hope,
the common man.
And if that last hope
of all
is
men,
taken off the stage,
of all men,
if that hope is taken off the stage, then we are in a serious crisis. Because, like we have, you know, been able to establish here today, the judiciary appears to be the balance between the other parties. If legislative is angry with executive, they come to court. If executive is angry with executive, citizens. So it's been like that, and we need to revive that sanctity. Let me bring in the example of the USA, though it's not the best example in the world, but at least a little bit higher. Donald Trump did everything to put a CJN in place, and you would have expected that he would benefit from that. But when he was voted out of office and he still felt like remaining in the White House, and the Americans said, no, you have to go, he turned everywhere, the executive, the legislative, the judiciary, and they said, no, you know, Donald Trump, you got to go, man. We have a system here, you know, and they were ready to move him out with wheelbarrow, if possible. So the system resisted his attempt to stampede democracy. And A question came up at that point in time in the minds of some, like myself, that imagine that that happened in an African country. You know, people will just start queuing behind the president. Oh, yes, yes, and begin to look for laws to make sure that person remains in office. So we need to come to a state where we have a system. And what is the principal advantage of having a solid system? When you have a very sound and effective system, it regulates the players, those who come to operate the system. But when you have a weak system, those who come to operate it, we operate it to suit their own personal vision at the expense of national vision. And that takes us back to the Constitution. Section 15, subsection 5, gives the state a mandate of Nigerian Constitution 1990 as amended, that the state shall abolish, not even minimize, abolish corruption and abuse of office. So we expect that those who are engaging this particular crisis will manage it effectively, and like Barrister Blamir suggested, put the check mechanism in place so that we don't find ourselves going back to these embarrassing situations. Because if you know politicians very well, and the high and mighty that want to take advantage or disadvantage of the judiciary, and they don't relent. You know, they keep, you know, coming back and coming back. If you let them know that you come to our courts, you can only be confronted with justice, then they operate in a way that minimizes the other vices we have in the society.
Okay. Now, when we talk about the issue of system, we often mention this system. We've seen cases, like you mentioned, the United States and other Western countries or developed countries, however we want to put it, where the player, the politician, might want to be mischievous, but the system regulates and keep things in check. We've seen all of that, like you mentioned. But within the system, there are also human beings. It's not machine. Yeah. It's not animals. It's not vegetation. They are human beings who are supposed to maintain that system. Now, the judiciary is one of the mechanisms, like he's saying, where whatever you do, when things fall out, you have issues, you come to the judiciary, they set things right. You may like it, you may not like it, but, you know, everything goes back to normal. But in a situation where we have, you used the word mischief earlier, what kind of consequences should there be as a way of keeping the system in check when we have cases like this that negates the standards of things and the ideals?
You see, one of the reasons why we are having this, a circumstance that we're having now, the embarrassing situation we're having now, is because people are not being punished. You know, this is not the first time we're having this kind of situation. In fact, the state that should protect corruption, that should advocate corruption, are the one encouraging it. Because this issue of ex parte order are always used by the government to achieve their goals. That's, for me, that medical situation with the order, as far as I'm concerned, is an abuse of use of ex parte order. The removal of our Chief Justice of Nigeria by way of ex parte order, it's an abuse of ex parte use, and it's by the government. So when the government is also encouraging, as far as I'm concerned, even the CJN now is a beneficiary of ex parte order, because if without the ex parte order that removed the former CJN, it will not be there. So, and he gladly not accepted it. He didn't protect and say, look, the process of removing my predecessor is not fair, so I won't take this. Nobody's been punished. Nobody's been punished. People are not being punished. I expect this summon is not enough to deter anybody from committing for that crime. But I know the CJN has no power on his own to punish anybody. It is the NJC that has the power. And I'm aware they say there's a meeting coming up next week or so. I hope a query will be issued to these judges to these judges. And I also hope that the body of bench disciplinary committee will also call the lawyers involved and ask. Unfortunately, most of these people who are in this body of bench or who are in this legal disciplinary committee, some of them are also involved in this. I don't know them, but I know most of them are senior lawyers, and they are also part of this. So, in other words, to me, one of the solutions to solve this issue of ex parte order, particularly in political matter, is to outrightly outlaw any granting of ex parte order in a political matter, because there is no way, there is no political case that cannot wait or that cannot wait, because if assuming Sekondu was a removed now, he can challenge it and continue to challenge it. And if you, if at the end of the day he wins the case, they will ask him to be reinstated, and he can come back to it, to the place. So there is nothing to lose, even if you, so there is no hurry as far as I'm concerned to warrant ex parte order in any situation. In so they, we should outrightly at law granting of ex parte order in any political matter. That right. That will stop that, because today that is the situation. That was how Adam Osemele was removed, ex parte application. Nothing has happened today. So I think it's not. It's
all bad. Right. We have to leave it here now. The point there is we've learned. In fact, I'm not a learned person, but
well, let me say this, Mike. I put it to my learned colleague.
Just in 30 seconds.
That when you abolish ex parte order, it's like cutting off a head that has headache. Okay. I would rather suggest that we build the culture of ethical practice, because again, if we say we are going to abolish it, the situations that will need
ex parte.
I'm talking about political matters. But I don't see any
exigencies
I believe there are cases where there is a time frame.
We have to wrap up now.
Thank you very much, Jide Ologun, for coming on the program. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for taking me to the classroom.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Malena.